In this video, we want to look at deaf child topic under ENT, ear. So how do you define deaf child? A child with profound hearing loss, that is greater than 90 decibel loss, or if there is total deafness, fails to develop speech. So this is deaf and fail to develop speech is mute. So these children are termed as deaf mute or deaf and dumb. Basically, they don't have any issues with their speech producing apparatus, but as they have not been accustomed to hearing, they will not be able to develop speech. So in this video, we want to look at the causes. Okay, mainly we want to look at the causes of deaf child. So look at this. There are three things here, three categories: prenatal causes. So prenatal causes. Then you have perinatal causes during birth and postnatal causes after birth. Okay, so this is what you have to know. So first, let us look at prenatal factors, prenatal causes. Prenatal can be infant factors or maternal factors. Two things can add up to, two things can cause a deaf child, prenatally. So basically, let us look at infant factors. Let's read these words, these terminologies are really complicated. Alexander dysplasia, Bing something dysplasia, Michel aplasia, Mondini dysplasia, enlarged vestibular aqueduct, semicircular canal malformation. Looks like this is the only one I actually understand at the moment. Semicircular canal malformation, okay. Enlarged vestibular aqueduct. Okay, let's look at these. First, we will develop our hearing and speech. So, hear this and learn how to pronounce them.
Scheib dysplasia, Alexander dysplasia, Bing Siebenmann dysplasia, Michel aplasia, Mondini dysplasia, enlarged vestibular aqueduct, semicircular canal malformations.
Okay, so the one we need help, this one. Let's read that one again.
Scheib dysplasia.
Yes, Scheib dysplasia. Then you have Alexander dysplasia, Bing Siebenmann dysplasia, Michel aplasia. This is the only one which has aplasia. Everything else is dysplasia. Mondini dysplasia, enlarged vestibular aqueduct, semicircular canal malformations. Let us look at all of these. So in the Scheib dysplasia, the dysplasia is seen in the cochlea and saccule. Hence, it is cochleosaccular dysplasia. This is nothing but cochleosaccular dysplasia. Dysplasia. So you should know the anatomy, right, to understand this. So if you have watched the inner ear labyrinth video, so you will know that saccule is here. This is the cochlea. So cochleosaccular dysplasia, isn't it? That's what they're saying. This is inherited autosomal recessive non-syndromic trait. Okay. Now let's move on to this one. Alexander dysplasia, it affects the basal turn of membranous cochlea. It affects what? Again, cochlea here. The basal turn of membranous cochlea. So only high frequencies are affected. High frequency affected. Okay. Residual hearing is present in low frequency. So this person will have residual hearing in low frequency. So you can anyways amplify with hearing aid. Moving on to Bing Siebenmann dysplasia. Here there is complete absence of membranous labyrinth. Oh, membranous labyrinth itself is absent. Okay. Then Michel aplasia, absence of bony and membranous labyrinth. Okay. So this one was absence of membranous labyrinth. This one, Michel aplasia, absence of bony and membranous labyrinth. So just understand that here it says complete absence of bony and membranous labyrinth. Okay. In this they are saying even the petrous apex is absent, but external and middle ears may be completely unaffected. So only inner ear is affected. That's what they are saying. Okay. You cannot even use hearing aid or cochlear implantation. Wow. So in the inner ear, if you see, you have bony, this is bony, right? Outside whatever is there is bony, and inside blue is the membranous. So you have bony outside and inside you have membranous. In Bing Siebenmann dysplasia, in Bing the bony is present. Okay. In Bing the bony is present. So membranous labyrinth is absent. In Michel aplasia, both are absent. Bony membrane is entirely absent. So in this, you can't give no hearing aids, or cochlear implantation can be used. Okay. Even petrous apex is absent. Okay. Let's make this red. They don't seem to be giving a very good picture about it. Okay. This Alexander dysplasia, not bad, because he's at least having some residual hearing, right? Okay. Then, let's move on to Mondini dysplasia. What is there here? Only basal coil is present or cochlea is 1.5 turns. So basically, normally cochlea should be 2.75 turns. But cochlea is 1.5 turns. Okay. It is less, okay. So normal will be around 2.75 turns. So what happens in such people? What do you think will happen? This one, they are saying that the basal coil is present or cochlea is 1.5 turns. There is incomplete partition between the scalae due to absence of osseous spiral lamina. This condition can be unilateral or bilateral. This deformity may be seen in some syndromes. Some specific syndromes are there in which they can be seen. Anyways, we are not going into so much of detail. Let's move on. Enlarged vestibular aqueduct. Let's move on to this one now. We are in this one. Enlarged vestibular aqueduct. In infant factors only we are there, guys, still. Let's look at that. Enlarged vestibular aqueduct. Currently we are here. Right? So, vestibular aqueduct is enlarged, greater than 2 millimeter. Endolymphatic sac is also enlarged, right? It causes early onset sensory neural hearing loss, which is progressive. Let's understand this. So, where is this sac? They are talking about endolymphatic sac. It's not very clear here. Wait. Show the endolymphatic sac. So, we are reading what? Enlarged vestibular aqueduct. Okay, here they are saying vestibular aqueduct is enlarged. Endolymphatic sac is also enlarged. Okay, so where is the vestibular aqueduct? Is this the one? Duct. ED. What is ED? Endolymphatic duct. So, they are saying the vestibular aqueduct is the bony canal, but it ends in the endolymphatic sac. So, the vestibular aqueduct is enlarged. The endolymphatic sac is also enlarged. Okay. So, this is enlarged vestibular aqueduct. It causes early onset sensory neural hearing loss, which is progressive. So, it keeps on increasing the hearing loss. Okay. Vertigo may be present. Perilymphatic fistula may occur. So, even a fistula can occur. Perilymphatic fistula may occur. Okay. So, where are we now? Enlarged vestibular aqueduct over. Last, semicircular canal malformations. So, let us look at this one now. Semicircular canals. So, this is the superior, is it? This is the posterior. This looks like the lateral one, right? So, in the semicircular canal malformations, both superior and lateral or only lateral semicircular canal malformations may be seen. So, this is lateral definitely. So, there can be lateral definitely will have some, and along with it even superior will have malformation. This can be seen on imaging. So, yes, anterior and superior, both names they are using for the same thing. Anterior, superior and lateral semicircular canal can have problem. Okay, so let's just revise this one. Infant factors. Let's revise infant factors. What was this? Scheibe dysplasia, cochleosaccular dysplasia, right? Alexander dysplasia. Alexander, remember, at least they can hear low frequency. Bing Siebenmann dysplasia, there is absence of membranous labyrinth, only bony is present, you can remember like that. Mitchell aplasia, both are absent, even petrous apex is absent, hearing aids, cochlear implantation, nothing will work. Mondini dysplasia, cochlea is just 1.5 turns, I think Mondini, remember Mondini as a circle, Mondini, some turns. Enlarged vestibular aqueduct, what did we see in this? Everything is enlarged, they can have vertigo, isn't it? But main thing you have to remember here is it is a progressive hearing loss, okay? Semicircular canal malformation, again, either the lateral is affected or the superior semicircular canal is affected. And you can see this on imaging. For enlarged vestibular aqueduct, they have said MRI, okay? Now we will move on to maternal factors. Deaf child maternal factors under prenatal, okay. Here. So maternal factors, let's go through from here. We will go faster because these are not difficult to understand. So maternal factors will be like infections during pregnancy, drugs taken during pregnancy, radiation. Right, radiation exposure, other factors. So let us look at this one, infections during pregnancy. Infections during pregnancy, you know the torch infections like toxoplasmosis, rubella, cytomegalovirus, herpes type 1, type 2, syphilis, right? So torch infections, you can remember, these can cause hearing loss in the fetus. Okay, drugs in used during pregnancy like streptomycin, gentamicin, tobramycin, amikacin, quinine, chloroquine, right? If it is given to pregnant mother, these can cross the placental barrier. They can damage the cochlea. Okay. So thalidomide also can affect the ear. It causes a lot of other abnormalities. Radiation. Now let's move on to radiation, guys. How's it going? What are we looking at? Maternal factors that cause prenatal causes of deaf child. Okay. Now, radiation exposure. Right, and then others, that's all we have to look at. Let us look at these. Radiation exposure, what are they saying? Okay, radiation exposure, especially in first trimester, because there will be organogenesis happening at that time. Then other factors, they are saying nutritional deficiency, diabetes, toxemia, thyroid deficiency, maternal alcoholism. Okay, all this can be a problem. So let's just summarize maternal factors. Infections during pregnancy like the torch infections, drugs during pregnancy like streptomycin, gentamicin, amikacin, quinine, tobramycin, so many of them. Then radiation exposure, especially in first trimester. And other factors are like nutritional deficiency, diabetes, thyroid deficiency, toxemia, maternal alcoholism. Okay. Fine. Let's move on. Perinatal causes. So let's move on to perinatal causes. From here, we will go fast. Don't worry, because these are not very, these are not that difficult to understand, isn't it? So you know, perinatal causes, what and all, anoxia, right? Anoxia is what? No oxygen supply, right? So basically, perinatal means what? During birth or early neonatal period, okay? Around the birth, you can say. So anoxia, it damages what? The cochlear nuclei, hemorrhage in the ear, placenta previa causes anoxia, right? Prolonged labor, cord around the neck, prolapsed cord, all these will cause fetal anoxia. Okay, then let's move on to this. Prematurity and low birth weight, babies which are born before term, preterm, that's only you know that. Birth weight, if it is less than 1500 gram or 3.3 pound. So it's a low birth weight baby, premature baby, low birth weight baby. Birth injuries by forceps, right? They can cause intracranial hemorrhage, right? And extravasation of blood into the inner ear. Then, let's move on, guys. What is next? Jaundice, bilirubin levels which are greater than 20 milligram percentage can damage the cochlear nuclei. My God, that's a huge amount, right? Normally, if it is greater than 2 milligram only, we call it as jaundice, isn't it? Wait, let's check. See, normal serum bilirubin level, I think this is for adult anyways, they are saying that it is 0.5 to 1.5. It is called jaundice if it exceeds 2 milligram per deciliter. It is milligram, right? So 20, if it's above 20, then it can cause damage to the ear. The thing is, newborns anyways will have high bilirubin, like 5 milligram per deciliter. So up till 5, we are saying it's normal, but their bilirubin levels vary by the hours. Okay, then neonatal meningitis. Just remember, for this jaundice, about 20 milligram percentage can damage the cochlear nucleus. Neonatal meningitis, again meningitis, infection of the meninges, inflammation of the meninges, the coverings of the brain, then sepsis, then time spent in neonatal ICU. So apparently the time spent in neonatal ICU can be a cause. Ototoxic drugs, obviously drugs which are used to treat all this meningitis, septicemia and all, can themselves cause hearing loss. So we are done with yet another heading, right? Perinatal. So what and all we saw till now? We saw prenatal, under that we saw infant factors and maternal factors, right? And now we are finished. Now we have finished perinatal causes. Can you summarize perinatal causes? Anoxia, jaundice, meningitis, stay in the ICU, neonatal ICU, ototoxic drugs, sepsis, then forceps delivery, then prematurity, low birth weight. Okay. For anything in perinatal, you will give the standard thing. Birth injury, premature baby, low birth weight baby. These things are kind of standard for anything. Postnatal causes. Let's go to postnatal causes. Postnatal causes, they have divided it as genetic and non-genetic. Let's understand why they are putting genetic here. So it manifests later in childhood or adult life. Genetic means it has come prenatally itself, but they are saying, they have put it here only because they are saying that later this deafness will manifest. Okay. They are giving some syndromes here. Alport syndrome, Klippel-Feil syndrome, Hurler syndrome, etc. Not much information there. Non-genetic, these are like acquired. These people get viral infections like measles, mumps, varicella, that's chickenpox, influenza, meningitis, encephalitis. They can have middle ear infections, right? Secretory otitis media. Actually, secretory otitis media is blue ear. It is not an infection. It is a sterile condition. Ototoxic drugs, trauma. Trauma is like, you know, fracture to temporal bone, middle ear surgery, perilymph leak. Lastly, they are putting noise-induced deafness, okay? Interestingly, here they did not put the normal otitis media. They have only put secretory otitis media under non-genetic conditions. So now we have looked at the postnatal causes. They have divided that as genetic and acquired or non-genetic. Non-genetic is like viral infection, ototoxic drugs, trauma, noise-induced deafness, secretory otitis media, that is glue ear, etc. Now let us move on very quickly to hearing assessment in children and infant. How will they assess? Because earlier they assess, it is better. Because their speech has to develop, right? So there are neonatal screening procedures, behavior observation, distraction techniques, conditioning techniques, objective tests. There are a lot of tests. All these have separate videos on themselves actually. Okay. Anyways, moving on. How will they manage a deaf child? First of all, parental guidance. Hearing aids, cochlear implants, okay, so to help the child hear. Then to develop speech and language, auditory, oral communication, manual communication, total communication. Education of the deaf, vocational guidance. Right? So that is it. In this video, we wanted to cover the causes of deaf child. We looked at what the definition is for deaf child. We looked at the prenatal causes. A lot of dysplasias we saw. Then maternal factors we saw. Then we saw perinatal causes. Then we saw postnatal causes. Then we saw just the names of the hearing assessments which are used to assess the hearing in infant and children. And how to manage deaf child, just the headings. So that's all for now in this video. We'll meet you in the next video. Bye bye.